Why is it so hard to get to Europa, Jupiter's moon? Europa is one of the four largest satellites of Jupiter, known as the Galilean Satellites, in honor of its discoverer, Galileo Galilei, who discovered them by looking through his telescope in the year 1610. When Galileo discovered these satellites, he did not imagine that 400 years later, enormous water reserves would be discovered in this place. Today, it is known that Europa is one of the bodies with the most significant amount of water in the solar system, and that it could even have all the conditions to host living beings. But if it is such an essential place for the search for extraterrestrial life, why haven't we been able to send a human-crewed spacecraft to explore this frozen world better? Why is it so hard to get to Europa? Stay with us to find out. First approach. On March 2, 1972, the Pioneer 10 space exploration probe was launched from Cape Canaveral. This spacecraft was part of a NASA program that aimed to take advantage of an alignment gap of the outer planets to explore the solar system's gas giant planets. This spacecraft would have many scientific instruments that would be of great importance to know the mysteries hidden in the solar system's outer planets, about which very little was known at the time. Launched with NASA's Atlas Centaur rocket with a high thrust force, the probe would leave Earth on a fixed course towards Jupiter to use it as a catapult to head for the outer solar system. The Atlas Centaur rocket accelerated the probe for a net interval of 17 minutes, reaching a speed of 51,682 kilometers per hour or 32,114 miles per hour. Several instruments were activated to perform tests as the spacecraft moved through the Van Allen radiation belts. 90 minutes after launch, the spacecraft reached interplanetary space, and 11 hours later, it approached the moon closely, becoming the fastest artificial object at that moment. The initial momentum and planetary alignment that occurred at that time helped the Pioneer probe reach the orbit of Jupiter on December 3, 1973, becoming the first space probe to explore this distant planet. But Pioneer also took advantage of that moment to explore the moon Europa, where for the first time in history, we could see that it was a much more complex world than we thought. 2 years later, the Pioneer 11 probe would also get close to Jupiter's moons, capturing new images with better definition. Both probes managed to cover the distance between Earth and Jupiter thanks to the vast initial momentum and the approaching gap that occurs roughly every 13 months between the two planets. Until then, the data sent back by the probes did not yet show that Europa could be an exciting moon, but that changed with the Voyager missions. The Great Find. However, the Pioneer 10 and 11 probes were much more fruitful than initially estimated. The Voyager program would give us the probes that could best reveal the secrets of the Jovian system. In the 1970s, after the apparent success of the Pioneer probes, NASA proceeded to continue the Grand Tour program. The NASA program initially aimed to send two sets of robotic probes to all the planets in the outer solar system, i.e. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto, which was still considered a planet at that time. Thanks to this program, the first group of spacecraft would be successfully launched, Pioneer 10 and 11. However, the project's enormous cost of about $1 billion led to its cancellation and replaced by the Mariner program, which later became the Voyager program. These spacecraft would have similar objectives to the Pioneer, with the vast difference being that they would have much more advanced technology, which had been developed thanks to the success of the Pioneer probes. They would also carry more fuel for more observing maneuvers and a longer-lasting battery that would allow them to use much more sophisticated scientific equipment. Voyager 1 was launched on September 5, 1977 from Cape Canaveral and would arrive at Jupiter in January of 1979, while Voyager 2 was launched on August 20, 1977 and would arrive at Jupiter on July 9th of the same year. Both probes would reach Jupiter in 2 years, taking longer than the Pioneer probes because they carried a heavier payload. This is a reminder that every gram taken into space drastically changes travel time. The heavier a spacecraft weighs, the longer it will take to reach its destination. The Voyager probes were the first to take the sharpest images of Jupiter and also the first to provide essential data on the composition and geological structure of Europa, which at that time had already become a place of great scientific interest, as its high albedo indicated that it probably had ice, which was confirmed by the images of the Voyager probes. A new goal. The two groups of probes, Pioneer and Voyager, initially aimed to take advantage of the approaching gap between the gaseous planets to explore them all and, in the process, take advantage of the momentum they would obtain to leave the solar system. But during those trips, images and data from scientific instruments show that Europa had a much cleaner surface than expected, meaning that it didn't have many impact craters. The only explanation for Europa's lack of impact craters was that some kind of geological activity constantly renewed its surface. And this was something completely new, since until then, no known artificial satellite showed geological activity. These discoveries raised scientific curiosity about the satellite. And thanks to observations from the Hubble Space Telescope, we discovered that Europa had geysers of water gushing near the South Pole. This finding significantly increased interest in Europa, as we had found water somewhere outside of Earth for the first time, and it was within our solar system. The interest in exploring Europa increased, and now the priority of exploration missions was no longer Jupiter. It became the moon Europa, since if there was water under this satellite's icy surface, we would likely find living beings. Before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve them for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. A very long journey. Thanks to all the discoveries that were made on Jupiter and its moons, NASA decided to send a new mission to explore not only Jupiter, but also its moons. This would be the mission currently studying this planet, the Juno Exploration Probe. This spacecraft was launched in August of 2011 and was supposed to arrive at Jupiter in July of 2016. But why did it take longer than the Voyager and Pioneer probes? The reason is simple. Weight. As we mentioned earlier, the heavier a spacecraft weighs, the longer it will take to reach its destination. The reason for this is the fuel that is used to propel them. All space probes carry some fuel to propel themselves in the vacuum of space. But once they reach a certain speed, the engines shut down so that they only continue to move forward thanks to the initial boost. In space, there is no friction, but there is a force that slows them down, the gravitational pull of the sun. That's why a lightweight spacecraft can fire engines at full power and accelerate to overcome the sun's gravitational pull. But a heavier spacecraft will need more momentum, translating into more fuel and heavier weight. Pioneer 10 and 11 probes weighed only 568 pounds or 258 kilograms, while Voyager 1 and 2 probes weighed 1,620 pounds or 735 kilograms and 1,796 pounds or 815 kilograms each. In comparison, the Juno probe weighs 7,991 pounds or 3,625 kilograms. As you can see, the Juno probe weighs much more than the Voyager and Pioneer probes combined. For that reason, although the initial impulse of the Juno probe was more significant, having a greater weight, it took much longer to reach Jupiter, taking approximately 5 years. A human-crewed spacecraft would weigh at least 10 times more than the Juno mission, so travel time would also increase. With today's most powerful rockets, a human-crewed spacecraft could not acquire a speed large enough to cover the distance between Earth and Jupiter in less than 5 years. The most conservative estimate is that a spacecraft at least 3 times larger than the Apollo spacecraft that took the first astronauts to the moon could cover the distance between Earth and Jupiter at best in 8.5 years, just for the one-way trip. This means that a round trip would take 17 years, something that is entirely unfeasible because to be in space for 17 years, astronauts would have to carry a lot of supplies, food, water, and fuel, which would increase the weight of the spacecraft even more, in turn increasing the travel time. The best-case scenario. As you can see, a trip to the moon, Europa, would not be accessible with modern technology. To undertake such a long journey, it would be best if astronauts could make brief stops at other places, such as the moon, Mars, and Ceres, the dwarf planet in the asteroid belt. If in a few years we were able to establish bases on the celestial bodies that are halfway between Earth and Jupiter, astronauts who undertake the journey to explore Europa could make the trip in less time, since they would not have to carry with them all the supplies they will need for the trip. The spacecraft would be much lighter and will be able to travel faster. Suppose that in the future we manage to put a base on the Moon, on Mars, and another on Ceres, with space bases always in orbit around these three bodies, with supplies such as food and fuel for travelers heading back to Jupiter's moons. In this scenario, if a spacecraft were to leave Earthbound for Jupiter, it could only carry the resources to get to each base it encounters. So once it arrives at the lunar space base, it will fill up with fuel to start the engines at full power and get to Mars as quickly as possible. Then on Mars, it will refill the tank to give a new boost that will take it at full speed to Ceres in the asteroid belt. And once there, it will refill the fuel tank to give it the last push that will take it to Europa, Jupiter's moon, in a record time of just 1.5 years. It would be similar to a car that wants to go around the world. It doesn't need to carry all the fuel it needs for the trip. All it has to do is fill up the tank every time it arrives at a gas station. Once in Europa, the astronauts could carry out their activities and stay there for a couple of weeks, then return to the spacecraft and make the same journey, passing Ceres, Mars, and the Moon, to finally return to Earth, in a journey that will have only lasted 3 years. Of course, there are a couple of problems with this hypothetical scenario. First, there's no space base on any celestial body other than Earth, and we may have to wait several decades to see something like this. The second problem is that for this plan to work, the Moon, Mars, Ceres, and Jupiter must be aligned, which doesn't always happen. The third problem is that even if this alignment occurs, which is perfectly possible, astronauts can only take advantage of the alignment for the outward journey, not the return journey, since by the time they reach Europa, the planets will no longer be aligned. So they would have to stay in Europa until the lineup is re-established, which could take several years. As you can see, getting to Europa is not an easy task. Our current technology does not allow us to reach this moon in a reasonable amount of time, and we do not have space bases on other celestial bodies to help us boost the ships during the journey. So until we have all these facilities, we'll probably have to wait many years to see the first human crewed missions to Europa. Do you think the trip to Europa would be so complicated? Let us know what you think in the comments.